Right now at 6, the Minnesota man accused of killing the mother of his children is back in court today.
And a retired Dairyland power plant goes out with a bang. Their future plans coming up.
Watching WKBT La Crosse, this is News 8 Now at 6.
Good evening, everyone, and thanks for joining us for News 8 Now at 6. I'm Ken Kozarowski.
And I'm Emily Brown. The man accused in the death of Winona mother Madeline Kingsbury is back in court today. 30-year-old Adam Fravel is charged with multiple counts of first-degree murder in connection to Kingsbury's death. Today's hearing was a back-and-forth over what case documents the public can and can't see.
Our own Jeremy Wall was in the courtroom today. He joins us live with the latest. Jeremy.
Yeah, Ken, Fravel's lawyers asked the court for a restrictive order preventing public access to grand jury transcripts and other evidence the grand jury used to indict him for Kingsbury's murder. They also asked the judge to suppress evidence from statements he made to police last April. Fravel's attorneys argue their client was not read his Miranda rights before police took his statement that day. Winona police officers who testified today admitted that was correct. In turn, prosecutors asked the court to block Fravel's attorneys from admitting evidence pertaining to Madeline Kingsbury's mental health, prescription drug use, and conversations with counselors or therapists. The court ruled in favor of the restrictive orders blocking access to grand jury evidence and also agreed to suppress evidence of Kingsbury's use of controlled substances, but left open the possibility that Fravel's defense attorneys may speak to witnesses about Kingsbury's mental health, so long as prosecutors are notified in advance of their intent. The court did not hear arguments today about a change of venue for Fravel's upcoming trial. That hearing is scheduled for a later date. Fravel is due back in court tomorrow, though. Live in Winona, Jeremy Wall, News 8 Now.
All right. Thank you, Jeremy.
Well, police in Two Rivers, Wisconsin say a blanket has been found that belongs to 3-year-old Elijah Vu. Investigators say the red and white plaid blanket was located less than 4 miles from the apartment where the child was reported missing on February 20th. Police say the blanket was found earlier in the investigation but did not give any other details. Volunteers across Wisconsin and beyond have been searching for Elijah, and authorities are still asking the public to keep an eye out for any evidence related to his disappearance. There's currently a $40,000 reward for anyone who has information on the case.
Yeah, another actually mild day despite the winds that were still continuing to blow outside. We got up to the 50-degree mark, but outside right now, still fairly mild, but that wind has picked up a little bit less as you go up towards Eau Claire, too, as the front has come through. Plenty of sunshine out there. So this evening, really, it's just going to be the wind as the story as it slowly decreases throughout the night, but still 38 degrees, not too bad for this time of year. Eau Claire, less than the wind. They'll see continue to decrease out of the northwest, with the wind temperatures getting back down to the 31-degree mark. Overall, the winds still are quite strong, especially further west and to higher elevations across the area. We have that front that is passing through the south. We'll start seeing that colder air arrive here later tonight and through tomorrow. Just some cloud cover out there, but overall, it's going to be clear skies throughout most of the night. As we time out, those temperatures will continue to fall into the 20s and eventually some teens as we get closer to tomorrow morning. That doesn't factor into the wind chill with some of that going on. So it will be a cold start for your Wednesday. But then we have even more winter weather coming after a cold Wednesday. We're going to have snow coming back in the forecast Thursday night and Friday. And that's why we have the alert day for accumulating snow that will impact the Friday morning commute. So I'll time that out later in the broadcast, as well as a more active weekend. We've had a string of very nice weekends, and that looks to come to an end this way.
All right. Sayonara. Thank you.
Whack jobs and morons. That's what Wisconsin's top Republican is calling the people organizing a recall against him. Assembly Speaker Robin Voss not holding back on his right-wing critics who filed a petition this month to try and force a recall vote. Members of Voss's own party have turned against him the last few years because of disagreements over the 2020 election. While Voss did hire former State Justice Michael Gableman to investigate election fraud claims at taxpayer expense, Voss fired him a year after Gableman found no evidence of those claims. He's also refused to impeach Wisconsin's Elections Administrator Megan Wolf over those same fraud claims. Criticism against Voss has even come from former President Trump, who endorsed Voss's primary opponent back in 2022. At a WisPolitics luncheon today, Voss says a recall is unlikely.
There's a ton of fraud. And the challenge that we have is the people who organize this are so out of touch with reality. And I'm just going to keep saying it over and over again. They are morons. They are stupid. These people do not deserve the respect that anybody gave them in the media.
The Wisconsin Elections Commission says the recall petition did not have enough valid signatures on it. ABC affiliate WISN in Milwaukee reports Racine County's DA has received dozens of complaints of fraudulent signatures on that petition. A final recall effort review is still in progress.
Today, the Genoa power plant went out with a bang. The demolition took place this morning, briefly closing Highway 35 and part of the Mississippi River. Today's demolition comes after the coal-fired power plant was retired and decommissioned over 3 years ago. It provided power for the Cooley region for over 50 years. The CEO of Dairyland Power Cooperative says the company has been working to close its coal power plants as they move towards using sustainable energy.
Transitioning to, for us, which is lower reliance on fossil fuel, moving to more renewables. This is the sixth closure, just to show our commitment to carbon reduction.
Rich says they're looking to redevelop the land and start on a renewable energy plant in a few years.
After 14 years of service, the 10th Bishop of La Crosse is retiring, and his replacement has been announced. Pope Francis announcing earlier this morning he accepted La Crosse Bishop William Patrick Callahan's retirement request after nearly 47 years as an ordained Catholic priest. The Pope then appointing Bishop Gerard Battersby to succeed Bishop Callahan and serve as the 11th Bishop of the Diocese of La Crosse. Battersby shared with News 8 how he intends to begin his new role in the La Crosse area.
My initial desire is to listen. And before I start to teach, I have to know the hearts and the disposition and hopes of my people. And so that's going to take some time.
Battersby will be installed as the Bishop of the Diocese on May 20th at the Cathedral of St. Joseph the Workman. Bishop Battersby is currently an auxiliary bishop in Detroit.
President Biden is trying to stop Israel from attacking a past Hamas stronghold, fighting concerns about the attack on a common enemy when we come back.
And two campaigns, two very different roads to presumptive party nominations. The latest from the campaign trail and the challenges ahead for President Biden and former President Trump.
The U.S. is taking a tougher stance with Israel over its war to destroy Hamas. President Biden spoke with Israel's prime minister by phone yesterday for the first time in weeks, telling him not to invade the southern Gaza city of Rafah without a plan to protect civilians. A team in Washington is discussing an alternative for a ground invasion of Rafah, Hamas's last stronghold and where more than a million civilians are seeking shelter.
The president told the prime minister again today that we share the goal of defeating Hamas, but we just believe you need a coherent and sustainable strategy to make that happen.
According to the world body that declares famine, virtually half the population of Gaza is now officially starving.
Presumptive GOP nominee Donald Trump is expected to easily win his party's primaries in five states today, including Florida, where the former president cast his own ballot. This comes as President Biden, also expected to sweep the contest on his side, courts voters out west.
CBS's Skylar Henry has the latest from the White House.
Presumptive GOP presidential nominee Donald Trump cast his vote in the Florida primary.
We need patriots. We need strong people in our country. Our country's going downhill very fast.
Five states held contests Tuesday, further teeing up the expected Biden-Trump rematch in November. Voters say their candidate is the right pick for America.
I voted for Donald Trump. I believe he's the only one who's willing to stand up for the Constitution as it was written.
Joe Biden, I think he's the only candidate that offers us freedom, democracy, and freedom for everybody.
Trump is experiencing a serious cash crunch for both his legal battles and his reelection campaign, while Biden is spending considerable amounts of money to reach two key groups of voters.
For our abuelos.
Biden's campaign is out with new ads this month, speaking directly to Black and Latino voters about his economic record and other issues. The president is on a three-state swing to win back support among Latino voters, which recent polls have shown is diminishing. He told volunteers in Reno, Nevada, they're critical to a second term.
I'm confident. I'm confident we get our message out to the American people. We're going to win again. But here's the deal.
You're the ones that are going
to
do it.
Biden has stops planned in Arizona, then heads to Texas for more fundraising. Skyler Henry, CBS News, the White House.
Coke is making changes to its bottles.
What's to do with the number one soft drink when we come back?
We definitely have cold conditions, more like end of February conditions for your Wednesday, but then we're tracking snow for Thursday night. That's why we got the alert day in there. I'll track how much, when to expect it, and what the weekend looks like coming up. All that on your First Warning Weather Update coming up after the break.
Thank you for watching News 8 Now. Expect more.
Soon, you might feel a little better about grabbing a bottle of Coca-Cola. Starting this week, all versions of Coca-Cola sold in 20-ounce bottles will be made from 100% recycled plastic. Coca-Cola estimates the changes will keep 2 billion plastic bottles from polluting the earth. The new bottles will bear a label signifying the change, but the bottle itself won't look or feel any different. The watchdog group named Coca-Cola the world's top plastic polluter for the sixth consecutive year in 2023. Coca-Cola aims to complete the rollout nationwide by the end of the summer.
Satisfying your sweet tooth with chocolate is getting more expensive. A recent report from Wells Fargo found dwindling supply around the world is causing cocoa prices to skyrocket. Part of those supply issues have to do with climate, including tree diseases brought on by heavier rainfall. Cocoa tree farmers in West Africa are also dealing with dry temperatures and extreme winds from this year's El Nino. The price for cocoa has more than doubled over the last year. I know.
And we've seen those dry conditions throughout this area. We see a lot of burn bans this time of year because of those conditions. But what we're going to see later this week is a little bit more precipitation. And it's going to feel a little bit more like February should, Greg.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pretty much we're going to see a lot of much needed beneficial rain and or snow here by the time we get to this point next week. Some areas could pick up over 2 inches of rain or snow combined together. So that definitely will help the drought situations. But for tomorrow, it's really going to feel like the end of February with the temperatures and the wind chill that'll be going on, and then attention turns to the snow that'll be coming Thursday night through Friday morning, which means we probably will have a messy Friday morning commute for some. Won't last that long, but definitely we're going to see the snow come back in the picture. But for tonight, the winds will slowly die off, but it will take some time, so you'll see a wind chill overnight. Few clouds here and there, but overall we're going to start off pretty much colder than we were this morning, up to the teens up to the north, to the low 20s to the south. All in all, tomorrow temperatures are going to struggle despite the sunshine to really get much higher than freezing in the afternoon. In fact, some areas up to the north will struggle to get to 30 degrees, so about 10, maybe even 15 degrees below where we should be for this time of year. And then tomorrow evening, we'll see the winds finally start to drop off probably for tomorrow evening. And then clouds will start increasing from the northwest, but still it's going to be quite chilly as we go through Wednesday evening, and that'll be for a cold start to Thursday. Wind chills wise, we'll definitely see the wind chills drop off tonight. You'll be in the teens, and then later as you wake up tomorrow morning, more into the single digits, maybe even single digits below zero up to the north. So it's going to be a very cold start for Wednesday. Not much improvement for the wind chills as we go through noon, maybe up into the teens, and then in the afternoon, probably more areas getting close to the 20s. So once again, that's more like the end of February type temperatures. But then the snow, and that's why we got the alert day. It's really for Thursday night through Friday morning. Hazards travel 2 to 6 inches. There's going to be a small area that's going to get close to that 6, and then a lot of the other areas will probably get closer to 2. This is grassy areas. How much accumulates on roads really just determines what the temperatures look like at that point, but it will create probably for a messy Friday morning commute. As you track that out, you'll see it spread snow across the area probably after midnight, and then we're going to see a band kind of set up somewhere generally in the area, kind of a west to east band that will begin to sink south and then push east towards Friday noon, and then actually begin to wrap up with maybe a few showers continuing into Friday afternoon. So that's kind of the track we're looking at. Very small system that comes from the northwest and slides eastward. So Thursday PM commute looks good. The snow will come in sometime after midnight through about noon. Once again, mainly light, but there will be an area that could be moderate to heavy snow at one point. Slippery or maybe slushy, depending on how things plan out for Friday morning's commute. But with the temperatures that should begin to rise up, I think by noon we should see mostly wet conditions on road surfaces. Once again, that 2 to 6 is more in grassy areas. This time of year, it gets a little more tricky how much actually accumulates on roads. It just depends on the road temps and the time that it actually does snow and how heavy it comes down to that point. Right now, the main area band right now beginning to shift a little bit here and there, but really looking at 70-80% greater than 4. This would be through Friday morning, not the total accumulation, but right now that band has continued to shift a little bit south north. So it probably will continue to do that for the next 24 hours or 36. So we'll continue to track that exactly where that ends up being, because that'll be the greatest impact to road conditions for Friday morning. But for tonight, we're looking at teens up to the north, 20s, definitely colder. That window continues, so there will be a wind chill throughout the night, especially towards tomorrow morning. And that's the main story of tomorrow morning, single digit wind chills, temperatures only barely getting above freezing or even 30s up to the north. Pretty cold conditions. And then after a dry Thursday, we're going to see snow begin to pull into the area Thursday night into Friday morning. So we have the alert day for the Friday morning commute issue. Once we have a dry Saturday, then it gets wet and really uncertain for Sunday through next Tuesday. Significant amounts of snow could happen, rainfall, thunderstorms. Someone's going to get a lot of snow with this heavy red snow. It's just
it
a lot of determination. So right now it looks like it may start at rain, snow, then turn over Sunday night to rain and more rain Monday. But where that line ends up in the area is yet to be determined. So more to come on that once we get past Thursday.
Sure. A lot going on there.
Yeah.
Okay.
A lot that you'll continue to track, of course, as well. Thank you, Greg. Yep. Coming up next in sports, the Timberwolves take on the defending champs tonight at the Target Center. Plus, the Badgers will have their hands full on Friday as Wisconsin tips off the first round against 31-3 James Madison. Rob is up next.
Covering all of the exciting action from your community, here's News 8 Now's Rob Schiff.
The goal for every team at this point in March is to be playing your best basketball of the season. And when it comes to Wisconsin, the Badgers are doing just that as they gear up for their first round matchup this Friday night in New York. Despite struggling down the stretch, the Badgers bounced back in a big way when it mattered most. Three straight wins to start the Big Ten tournament. One of those coming against top-seeded Purdue, a team the Badgers fell to twice during the regular season. Then on Sunday, Wisconsin was just a couple minutes away from securing its fourth win in 4 days. Badgers ultimately falling short in the Big Ten title game against Illinois, but Wisconsin earns the 5 seed in its regional. That sets up a date with James Madison this Friday in Brooklyn. Dukes finished this year with 31 wins. That's tied with UConn for most victories in Division I this season. Badgers head coach Greg Gard knows that it's never an easy ride, no matter who the opponent is at this point of the season.
To continue to play well, I think that's the main thing, is where we're at right now and how we've been playing the last 6 games. We got to keep our foot on the gas in that regard, see how far we can roll this down the road.
Should be a fun scene from Brooklyn on Friday night. Wisconsin and James Madison tip-off scheduled for 8:40 p.m. On the pro hardwood tonight, a big-time matchup in the Twin Cities. Two of the top teams in the West will square off tonight at the Target Center. Maybe we'll see that. Timberwolves welcome in the defending champion Nuggets. Minnesota and Denver both come into this one with the exact same record at 47-21. Both teams are just a half game back of OKC for first place in the West. We'll see if Anthony Edwards can add to that highlight reel tonight. Him and the Wolves will look for their 4th straight win. Tip-off is at 8. Staying in Minnesota, the Wild are running out of time. Just 14 games left in the regular season for Minnesota. Wild find themselves 5 points behind Vegas for that final wild card spot in the Western Conference. Minnesota still does have 2 games against the Knights down the stretch. We'll see if they can make up some ground as we get close to the postseason. As for tonight, Wild continue their road trip in Anaheim against the Ducks.
Quack, quack, quack.
I'm still mesmerized by the Anthony Edwards dunk.
Isn't that
and
nice?
You were even reacting
to it.
Yeah,
that was nice,
I could watch that all. I mean, that's why I put it in there, 40 seconds straight of just different angles.
Yeah, I mean, you kind of feel bad for John Collins over there. I mean, you're like,
but there was something
man's got a family.
He's been doing that to a lot of players, too, so it's almost like karma a little bit.
Yeah, everybody's calling him like a new incarnation of MJ.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's got the bounce.
He's good, man.
He clearly does.
And he's fun. He's fun to listen to. He's fun to watch.
Fun to watch, for sure.
Absolutely.
Okay, we'll be right back after this.
All right, tonight is definitely going to be colder out there with 20s and even teens, but that doesn't factor in the wind chill with the winds continuing overnight, so they'll continue to fall. And that'll be the big story waking up is the wind chills in the single digits. They will improve a little bit, but still, that's end of February temperatures. And then the snow comes Thursday night and Friday morning. That's the alert day. Should be a messy Friday morning commute.
Just as we're
busy towards the end of the weekend.
Yeah, that bunny backdrop's going to have to change to something else.
Sure.
Thanks for joining us.
We'll see you at 10.